right. I want her to pay more too.
The Democrats are so miserable in a wonderful country, I don't understand it either.
And I will tell you, the greatest periods of growth in our country ever were times when the policies we favored were dramatically helping to lift up the middle class.
Will you admit that the person you're talking about paying, which, by the way, almost nobody pays no taxes, but the person you're supposedly talking about, they do that by gaming the system, correct?
Okay, fix it.
All right, let me ask you a question. Let me ask you a question then. Then you will come on board with Ted Cruz for a one-page tax form with a flat tax, no deductions, right? Because then there's nothing to gain.
I won't.
There's nothing to gain in that, Franklin. Everybody will pay. They'll pay their share.
Okay.
Why aren't you for that?
Because
you know how that guy, if that guy got away with paying no taxes, he got away with it because he's rich enough to hire a bunch of accountants and a bunch of lawyers and game the system. And everyday people that you supposedly care about, we can't afford a bevy of lawyers to game the system. So we're the ones that get screwed. You created the big system. We want rid of the IRS. We want a flat tax. We want something simple that everybody can do in an afternoon.
Well, that sounds good. How would you like to be able to do your taxes in about an hour or two?
That'd be great.
Here's what I made. Here's the percentage of it. Here's my check.
That'd be great.
Well, that'd be great. You said that'd be great. Would you be for it?
Ted Cruz has put that forward for years.
Where are we going to disagree? We're going to disagree about what those numbers are. That's what we're going to disagree about.
But no, you're not, because your side won't even discuss a flat tax. You're right. The real discussion is where are the breaks?
Sure.
Who gets what?
Sure.
Who pays what?
Absolutely.
Your side won't even discuss it.
Why?
Because you're invested in a bureaucracy.
I want to jump back to something else just to kind of keep this conversation going. Why is the Democrats so for immigration, illegal immigration?
Because they get the votes.
Now, I'm asking Franklin, why would they be for?
We're not for illegal immigration.
Okay, Ben. What are we for?
What we are for is a system that reflects the reality of what's happening.
We have a
system. The vast majority that isn't working.
Over a million a year.
First of all, let's have some honest answers.
Okay.
Immigration has been illegal immigration has been falling over the last 10 years. That's the truth.
Because of the Obama economy was so sucky, they would rather be in Mexico than here.
So would everyone.
Wait a minute, Franklin, I'm coming. Oh, all right, I'm back. Go ahead.
That's a fact. Number two, the vast majority of those people are coming here because Americans are hiring them. So why don't we have an immigration system that takes that into account and provides a legal way of doing that?
Well, actually, Frank,
I thought we did.
Number three,
what's a visa? What's a visa?
It galls me to heck.
What is a
that
visa?
You guys aren't more angry at the people who invite them here and hire them
actually,
than
Frank,
you are at the people who just want to come here and work.
The Republican plan that your party just rejected called for E-Verify and called for penalties, and your guys voted against it. It was in our plan.
Because your plan had all these other restrictions that made it impossible.
We were doing away with chain migration, which the vast majority of the public wants done away with, and we were putting
Good morning, Bradley, Cleveland, Coach Shriver here on the morning show here on Saturday morning. Our wrestling show with Coach Slogsden and myself. Going to discuss some wrestling here this morning. It's all about wrestling now for our local teams. And we're glad to have you with us. Last week we seemed to be kind of lacking in subject matter, but we managed to do a pretty good job, I thought. And this week we got an overabundance of stuff to talk about. And, of course, now that we're headed to the state duels next week over in Williamson County at the Ag Center, we're going to discuss some things. It really doesn't matter what the rankings are now, all that out there, because we're in the tournaments now. Right now, Cleveland is still number one, and they're the one everybody is shooting for, trying to catch up and get back at them. And there's some interesting things happened this week. Coach Logsdon, how you doing this morning, buddy? All right, good. All right, let's talk about the week. Did you make it to the Saudi Bradley match?
I did.
All right, your opinion.
Gym, that little round dome that they wrestle in, and it was a great environment, and you know both teams really needed this one.
Mm-hmm.
They really needed to win, and they knew it, and you know it was good for me personally because I got to sit up there in the stands and watch it. I sat with four of the referees and past referees, and sat next to Danny Gilbert, and sat next to Al Miller was up there, and just a bunch of the old timers up there. It was kind of nice to share with them, and went down the floor and talked to Steve Henry for quite a while. And we always have a nice visit. He's a great dude, great guy. And but the match itself was, you know, it was good. It was a good match. It was there was some places that, you know, of course I see it through my Bradley black and gold lenses, and I look at how we could have done better in this place or that place. But you know, overall, I thought both teams brought it as well as they could.
Yeah. Well, the thing about it is, you take away, you make two pins, two decisions, and you got a tie match, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And then Henley, you know, Henley never should have lost that match, and he knows that. And you know, I mean, you dominate the match for the most, not dominate it, but, you know, you're clearly, you know, the dominant wrestler in the match. And, you know, he, in fact, when he got scored on, he, you know, he locks up a body lock around the kid, goes in and he's already beaten him. He locks up a body lock and he takes him to the mat. You know, I told Henley at school yesterday, day before yesterday, I said, Henley, what's the most underappreciated move in wrestling? I don't know, coach. I said, the post. You've got to post. When you hit the mat on a throw, a headlock, you know, momentarily let go, post on the mat, straighten your arm, post it, stop the momentum, then re-grab what you had. Mm-hmm. And Henley doesn't he doesn't do that. He holds his hands locked. And there's nothing to stop his momentum. If that guy explodes, and that guy just exploded, the guy panicked and powered through it, and Henley still got his hands locked around him. And it goes from being a five-point move for Henley and a pin to this kid's got him on his back for a five-point move. And that's only 5 points kid scored in the whole match, was rolling through when he got thrown to his back.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's unfortunate, but that's a learning opportunity for Henley. And in the state tournament, maybe he'll post in the state traditional.
Yeah. Well, it had to be a good match, and I knew we called that last week. We said it was going to be a good match, and it may have turned out even closer than it might have been. But that was great. That was sad for Bradley to have to lose that one. Of course, what that did, and then, of course, the same night, Cleveland wrestled three matches against Udawah, Mackman County, and Ray County, and they won all three. And then we went to Wednesday night, and Cleveland and Walker Valley wrestled, and Cleveland won that one. And then we go back to Thursday night. I mean, you talk about a full week of wrestling. Then we go right into the duel, region duels at Bradley, Thursday night. And I guess I was a little disappointing in the crowd Thursday night, but yet I wasn't surprised. I had already told somebody, I said, there'll be fewer people here tonight for four teams than there was for our duel match. It's just something about that duel that brings on the competition and everything.
Yeah, I was disappointed in our Bradley fans. Just, you know, I get up there, and it's maybe 10 minutes before the match, and I sit on the opposite side up there, that little top mm-hmm. level where some of our people sit sometimes. I decided to sit over there, get a better look at the match, and I'm sorry, and the match is going to start in 10 minutes maybe.
Right.
And I'm looking around, and I'm, you know, looked over Ron, and I said, where's the Bradley fans? Where are our fans at? You know, and it's that way. I've seen it run both ways. I've seen Cleveland do the same thing in the past where if you know you're outmanned and you know the team's going to – they've already whipped you a couple times, and they're just a stacked team and they're a little better, you know, people tend to stay home sometimes. And of course, the other team brings it. I saw people over in the Cleveland. I had a view of Cleveland over there from where I was, and you know, a lot of people looked at it and said, he's not a wrestling fan. That guy's not a wrestling fan. You know, they don't come, but if they know that they're going to watch Cleveland whip Bradley in anything, they're going to show up in mass, and they did, just like Bradley fans do.
Yeah.
Well, but I was just disappointed in was the fact that, you know, I didn't see a lot of Bradley fans there. And that's no way to be a Fairweather fan.
Right.
You know, you got a traditional program like that that's done good. Those boys are paying the price every day. They're cutting weight. They're sacrificing. Show up and, you know, show up and support them. And these are my people. I care about Bradley, but nevertheless, I'm disappointed that I didn't have more people there.
I agree. And I think, too, on that night, and I thought Bradley wrestled a whole lot better match against Cleveland than we did in the first, even though I think the first match was more exciting. That's just the way it was. I guess it's a dual meet. It's the first time in the year or that kind of thing. I thought some of your kids really, really came out there to do the right thing. And there were some great matches, some tough matches that could have gone the other way. And again, when you get into that situation, it's like against Saudi Daisy. You lose by six, and hey, one or two matches here or there, and you're changing that around. So it's one of those things that you have to be cautious. We talked about earlier about the fact that Saudi Daisy, and I was proud of Walker Valley. I thought they wrestled a pretty good match against Saudi, and you know, especially in some weight classes. But again, they beat Walker Valley, and you know, a lot of people thought that they were just going to turn and run and go home and forfeit. And so when they were hanging around, and I saw they still had their wrestling shoes on and all that kind of stuff, and they were sitting over there and watching the end of the Cleveland Bradley match and all that. Obviously, they had felt that they stood a chance, and I think that was the reason to wrestle was, well, if we can upset them, you know, that puts us, you know, number one. And
it puts them opposite Science Hill, who's a returning place, state place winner last year, and they're going to be in it. Mm-hmm. And so basically that sets up a semifinal where you're wrestling somebody like Cleveland will absolutely, because they're going to walk through the whole tournament. They're just mm-hmm. the better team this year. But they're going to cakewalk to the finals. Mm-hmm. I mean, there is nobody can right. even be in their zip code. And the only team in there that's near anybody's level, I think, is Science Hill, from what I've seen. Mm-hmm. And so I think Saudi thought, if we can somehow beat Cleveland in their state that they're in, having some guys sick and out, then maybe we can get opposite,
right.
you know, opposite Science Hill and get to the finals that way. Because Cleveland's going to beat Science Hill, no doubt about it. But Saudi may or may not beat Science Hill. Probably will. Don't know though. It's close. Well, they know they have an easier route to the finals. So sure. Let's try to knock off Cleveland as they're weakened state, get to the finals and face Cleveland in the finals.
You're right. You're right. And that was the thing too the other night is they decided to wrestle Cleveland. And, of course, as it ended up, they wrestled through the whole thing, and it was like 33-27 was the final, I believe. And so it came down there towards where there was a possibility of something happened. But I think they really felt like, and it gave a heck of an effort, that they could beat them. And so they had good planning, good all that. True, Cleveland had a couple kids out sick. But, hey, that's part of the game, and, you know, we always hate it. I think it's the saddest thing at this time of year. Especially when we start in these tournaments, when any team, any person, I don't care who it is, when they get sick, you know, you've worked all year, you've done what you had to do to get where you are, you know, a flu or a bug or something like that catches you. And I tell you what, when it puts you down for a couple of days, it takes a lot out of you. And so, you know, I'm always praying that these kids can stay healthy through the tournaments because it happens every year. You know, it's going to happen somewhere, but... Anyway, those are all possibilities. Those are all real-life things. They happen, so you just have to step up. Somebody has to step up, fill in, and scrap and scrap and scrap. So,
I'd like to caution some coaches, you know, if I could talk to them about – you see it in the papers a lot, not so much in person, but in the papers you read this, and you hear that a lot. You hear about, well, we're down, we're sick, we're this, we're that, we're young, we graduated 17, yeah. And all these, there's all these excuses. You know,
doesn't change.
And the thing is – you know, that's not untrue. It is true. The flu goes around. But it's also true that everyone goes through this stuff. Exactly. Every rest of the room has bouts of ringworm. You have to deal with things like that. You have the flus. You have viruses. I think a thing that G.P. West told me all those years ago, grandfather of Bradley Wrestling, you know, of Tennessee Wrestling, to me, G.P. West told me, he said, you know, that's part of coaching. Don't ever apologize for winning a match if the other team's down for this, that, the other reason. He said part of coaching is getting your guys ready, getting them there, keeping them eligible, keeping them out of trouble. It's keeping them from getting ringworm, making sure they shower after practice. It's making sure talking to them about not sharing drinks and kissing a girlfriend right now and stay virus-free and get them there healthy. So that's as much wrestling as a double-leg takedown, and that's part of it. And, you know, sometimes – some of it's luck, some of it's preparation, whatever, but it's just part of it. And to get in the paper and to make excuses. And of course, the first thing a coach will say is, I'm not making excuses, but here come the excuses.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, I know it's a fact. They are beat up, but you got to remember everybody's somewhat beat up.
Yep.
And if you're more beat up than somebody else, maybe you didn't prepare. Maybe you didn't prepare them as well. Maybe it's bad luck. I don't know.
See, that's the thing is, and you're exactly right in that fast. As far as the sickness and stuff goes, maybe you didn't prepare them well enough on how to stay healthy, how to stop getting sick, how to eat right, how to drink right, how to do all these kind of things. You know, if you work hard in practice and you're trying to cut some weight, Hopefully it's not too much. But again, if you're doing it the right way and you're eating right and drinking right, the key things that your body needs, and also to fight off, you know, being immune, the immune system working, you know, that's all part of that. Like you say, the strategy. There's more than takedowns and pins and, you know, all the kind of things that go through. That's all part. As a matter of fact, you know, probably when you get right down to it, it may be 80% of the whole thing is the fact that you get, I look at it maybe as staying healthy, doing things the right way, eating right, doing those things right, maybe 80%, 10% your conditioning and 10% your knowledge, and you put it all together, you got a pretty darn good team and program and wrestler. So
I think the sign of a good program, too, along that same vein is if that does happen and a kid does, something happens, and we had Vince Aguilar got a staph infection years ago, and, you know, things happen, and just viruses, whatever, like Cleveland's got some problems right now. Well, when a kid does get pushed out of the lineup, then a new whole thing comes in to play, and that is, have I prepared my JV adequately enough to step up and fill in? And even if there's no one there, then am I savvy enough as a coach to say, okay, who can I bump where? All right, this guy, I can bump this kid up a weight. I can bump this kid in. I can move. You know, you have to move around. It's a chess match sometimes, and that's part of coaching as much as double A's too. And some coaches don't take advantage of that. They just, you know, they pout and, you know, this guy's out. Oh, my gosh, we're great. You got to look at it like an opportunity. What are we going to do? How are we going to be clever here?
Well, I've always believed that the best statement you can make is attitude is everything. And I don't care how bad things get or how bad things are. You got to be positive. You got to be upbeat. And as a coach, that's your job. If you show one sign of negativity, you show one weakness in some way, kids pick up on everything.
Absolutely.
And you have to also make sure your assistants and everything, you know, I don't want to hear an assistant saying something, well, you know, that's just the way it, you know, that happens. We're just down, all this kind of, I want my assistants being more positive than me. And so you have to be able to, a lot of it is mental. You just convince these kids that they can do more than they can, and if they'll work hard, they get the chance.
Yeah, the head coach sets the tone for everything. I was lucky enough to get, I was asked to go speak to an elementary school after the break there. Robbie Winters out at Michigan Avenue asked me to come out and speak to his teachers about something, and this is the very thing is what I talked about. One of the things I talked about with them about, you know, attitude and setting the tone. It's no different than in a classroom. A teacher sets the tone, and, you know, the kids in your classroom, the kids on your wrestling mat, and they don't care if you've had a bad night, exactly. If you've had a bad, you and your wife are arguing, if whatever. They're not supposed to care. They're children. They're not supposed to be in an adult world thing. And so, you know, when you go in there, your job is, okay, you know, it's been a pretty crappy night, and, you know, things aren't going my way. Now, shift gears right now and get that face on and go in there upbeat and positive and lift your head up and quit scowling and get in there, and you make it a great day regardless. And just like you said about assistants, you know, it flows from the top. And if that coach can't control his own emotions and he pouts and he, you know, you don't know what he's going to be one day to the next, then that filters down to everyone else, and then it filters down to the kids. Just as you said, the kids catch on to that in a hurry, and it's kind of like, oh, what's coach going to be like today? Mm-hmm. What's my teacher going to be like today? They never know what they're going to get. It's a box of chocolates.
And see, that's another thing that I think a lot of times people don't realize is you don't know where that kid is coming from. Now, I think a little different in the sport of wrestling. We as coaches, I think, probably keep a pretty good close eye on what the background of these families are and what our kids are doing, maybe more so than any other sport. But the idea of the fact is, some of these kids, their home life may not be the best. You don't know what they're hearing at home. You don't know what they're coming in. Your practice that day may not be on their mind or may not be their priority right then because of something that has happened at home. And when kids are that young and so impressionable and they hear things, it affects their mental attitude. So you have to be, that's why the upbeat is so important and so positive. And I think one of the key things as a coach is open yourself up to tell your kids that they feel comfortable they can talk to you. They need somebody to talk to besides a friend. It's good to have a friend, but, you know, you never know who your true friends are until you're really in a down situation. So, you know, be a friend for them. Now, I'm not saying you don't, you know, that's it, goody, 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 you're okay, all that. I'm talking about feeling free to talk to your coach, and you be up front with them and everything, and you are concerned and show a lot of sincerity.
Absolutely. I agree.
Yep.
agree.
All right, folks. Well, let's think about, there's no need to talk about what's already gone on. Let's look forward to next week. Now, sadly, Bradley won't be going to the duels this week, but I'm sure, you know, I've always looked at it as you always have to look at the positive of things. That was what we just got through talking about. But the point is, for Bradley going into the next week, not being able to go to the duels, well, I think maybe in some aspects that could be a positive for them. I mean, you, losing is never a positive. You always want to lose or win. But the thing about it is, it gives them a couple weeks to kind of recoup, hopefully not get any sickness, keep their kids healthy, get everybody strong and ready to go for the traditional. And you know where the traditional is this year?
Where?
Where?
Yeah, same place.
Oh, is it?
Town Palace?
No, I'm talking about the our region, a traditional
year.
Oh,
I'm sorry. No, sir, I don't.
I haven't found anybody that knows. I was asking the other night over there at Thursday. I said, now, where is that one? I couldn't find anybody that knew. Anyway, that's the point. They got to get ready for that now and make the most of it. Get stronger, get healthier. And Cleveland's going to need to take off a little bit here, not take off, but they need to rest their kids too, try to get those kids healthy and get people back and working on that. And then hopefully they'll have another good week next week. And then you come on back around and we're talking about it again. But we're in tournament mode now, folks. We're going to be going a couple weeks here, going over there to the Williamson Center over there and for both the duels and the traditional. So we want to support all of our teams and all of their people who'll be going. Of course, we're concerned about our people here. We're concerned about Walker Valley. We're concerned about Bradley, and we're concerned about Cleveland. And we want them all to be successful. So, you know, but anyway.
In a sport where we stress, you know, work, and we are the workingest sport I've ever seen as far as day-to-day work ethic. And you add cutting weight and stuff like that to the whole thing. You've got to be in tip-top shape. But in a sport where we preach that and we live by that mantra, I think Ben and coaches like him that are not going to the state have to really guard, especially guys like Ben who are driven, hard-nosed coaches used to winning, and you're a little bit, your feelings are hurt, so to speak, because you're not going to the state. You're a little bit embarrassed by that, maybe, whatever. You have to guard against now gritting your teeth and say, okay, now we're just going to work like crazy and really get ready for the traditional. We're going to drive and drive. Because I've seen situations where you mentally burn a kid out, where he starts resenting the sport and resenting practice, you've lost him. You won't get him back this year. He mentally won't come back this year. Coach has got to play it cool. Yeah. You know, like I said, when it's time to work, man, it's time to work. And when it's time to play, it's time to play. When it's time to rest, it's time to rest. And he needs to make sure he balances that and lets these kids know, I'm not mad at you. We're going to try to get better. When it's time to practice, we're going to practice. We're going to go hard. But give them little treats. Right. I'm going to give you I'm knock off 30 minutes today, let you go home early. Hey, let's go bowling today. Mm-hmm. We're going to go. Things like that, I think, at this time of the year are utmost importance. He can't let the other side of his personality come out. We're just going to drive to the finish line. He'll burn some kids out, and it'll finish worse than it would have, in my
opinion. I've been in that position as a coach, and I made that mistake, and It's not fun. You have to do that to learn, and after you get it done and you've done it once, believe me, it makes an impression, and you don't forget that. But that's a key thing right there, and might have been a good idea, and I don't know what that is. None of my business. You know, after that Thursday night, you know, maybe you take a day off, or you just come in and roll around, just talk, and not have anything real serious on Friday and the weekend, and every Monday you start working back in, but you're not really. You know, you've got it. Main thing is conditioning. If you continue your conditioning, and as hard as Bradley has always done with the running, I think probably they have worked the hardest on that of anybody I've ever seen. Now, I used to run with my kids back in the day. Now, that was way back. But it was, you know, there weren't many of us, weren't many of them that were that dedicated to do that. But I think the Bradley program has probably shown that and probably based on that, because of Turner and you, the running part and everything. I mean, Turner ran when he couldn't run.
Yep.
And bless his heart, I remember coming up behind him once on the street. He's running down Key Street, and I pull up behind him. He's got those legs, and he's just kind of crimping around like that. And I stopped, and I said, man, you're making me hurt. Get in this car and let me take you back. And but I tell you what, he never let up, and he never give up. So I guess, you know, those are the kind of things, and I know all the stuff that you've done and everything. So that shows, that's an example, folks. That's a model for your kids. And, you know, that's not going to happen everywhere, folks. That you don't have that. It's surprising how little that may happen. But it is important. And, you know, like I said, you know, you got to, I don't care how far up you are. I don't care if you're talking about an NCAA, whatever. There's an aspect of fun that's got to be held into the sport. You've got to have fun doing what you're doing. Now, you got to be serious about it, but I think you have to have fun and make it fun for them sometime. Like you say, the idea of going bowling, the idea of, hey, let's go swimming. Let's go to an indoor pool somewhere and just swim, just relax. You know, rest those muscles, do those kind of things. And, again, that's it. Like you say, the tone is set by the coach. And kids all, you know, they come into the wrestling room and they're getting ready to, they know, oh, God, we're going to get killed today. And all of a sudden the coach says, hey, guys, let's go to a movie. Hey, guys, let's go bowl. Hey, guys, let's go swimming. So
I think one of the biggest things for a kid, I realized that, you know, I won't go any names here, but there was a time in my career through my all my coaching and through all my wrestling, rather, when you feel like, you know, this coach, he doesn't get it. He's forgotten what it's like to be cutting weight and wrestling three matches in a week and continually having to pull a bunch of weight and your studies and you having to juggle all this stuff. And he can't respond. He don't understand. I think what's really important for a high school coach especially is that the kids know coach remembers. Coach gets it. When you give a little break sometimes and you're kind to them and you talk to them and say, tell them, guys, look, I know this is tough. I get it, man. I remember it. I think if they know that you sympathize with them and you have empathy for what they're doing, it does make a difference. And over the years, I found that the more I did that, let the kids know I understand your pain, I understand what you're going through, the frustrations of it, they tend to respond a lot better if they know that you guys are a team working together rather than you're this tyrant that drives them mercilessly who never gives them a break because he don't know what it's like. He don't remember what it's like. He's too old. That's a real mistake by a coach to do that. You've got to let them know I get it. And I feel your pain, babe. I'm going to work with you on this. Yep. You know, I'd rather, if you're going to do a training for running, for instance, go to the track and run for an hour around the track. Or take them up there and for 25 minutes run intervals. Run tough, hard intervals with 30-second rest between each one. And then you have 35 seconds left. Get the Frisbees out. Let's play Ultimate Frisbee. And let's, you know, I think that's, it's a better workout physiologically. It's a better workout mentally for those kids. Yeah. And coaches have to understand those kind of things.
I can remember some of the, I think, most positive times as a coach is either before, during, or after a practice or something like that, and I would just stop them. We'd get in the middle of the mat, sit down, and just start talking and just saying, you know, I said, you know, guys, what's on your mind today? And, you know, how you feeling today? You know, let's just talk. You know, what's on your mind? You know, what's heavy? You got something heavy on your mind? You got some problems you want to talk with us about? You know, show them that there's more to you than a winning a wrestling match or all this kind of thing. You know, show them that you're human. I'll never forget the day when I think it was the first year I came to Cleveland in 1971. That's when the old mall was down there where Life Care is now. And it was the J.C. Penney's. My wife and I were walking into J.C. Penney's on Friday afternoon after school one day. And one of my students rode by on a bike, and he almost fell off the bike. He said, Mr. Shriver, what are you doing here? Like, hold it now. On Friday afternoon, they throw us in the room and lock us up and let us out on Monday. You know, there's more to it than that kind of thing. So show them you care. You know, until they know you care, you know, that's really key there. So that's good.
I used to let the kids know. To, and again, goes back that little talk I gave at Michigan Avenue. I mentioned this also then. I said, you know, I used to tell the kids, I said, listen, the things that we're learning here, the things I'm trying to teach you, the things that were taught to me about character and intensity and whatever, dedication, I said, wrestling, you guys may think that I'm just this Captain Wrestle Man, that all I think, live, and dream is wrestling, wrestling, wrestling. That's all I ever did. That's what I do now. I said, listen, If I had been influenced stronger by a member, a band person, and I'd gotten into the band, whether I'd been in the theater, like Johnny Lennon and, you know, those guys, I would have this, hopefully have the same intensity. I would teach the same characteristic traits. Wrestling happens to be my vehicle that I use. Happens to be. Wrestling is not the end-all, be-all of human existence. It happens to be what I do. Mm-hmm. The things I'm trying to teach you are so much bigger than any sport, any activity. And if you learn correctly, then it goes out into all parts of your life.
Definitely.
And I think that's important to teach the kids.
And that's a great point that people need to understand. You know, We have to be careful. And that's one thing I think adults get into, especially after we have kids. And I know I'm guilty of it. I was guilty of it. You know, we think our priorities sometimes are job. We forget, you know, God, family, you know, that's got to be your first two priorities. Your job should be down the line. It doesn't mean you don't work hard at it. It's not. It doesn't mean that you don't have goals and expectations. But again, folks, if your family is not up there and ahead of wrestling or whatever you're doing, you know, you got a problem. And there were times when I questioned that. There was time when I kind of got a little wondering about that. I wasn't putting too much emphasis in some areas. So I guess that's why I'm saying I'm fortunate my wife is still with me after 48 years, because there were times where she probably had a reason to walk off.
It's funny. It's such a fine balancing act. I mean, to do it right is so tough. What you're talking about, it's the balancing act is you want to stay, of course, dedicated to your family and their priority in your life. But then again, if you overplay that too much and you don't have Saturday morning practices, you go, that's when we go to the park, whatever, and you put that stuff in all the time in front of your activity, your wrestling, whatever you're doing, well, then you're halfway doing something. Then your program's mediocre, you're a mediocre coach, your kids are mediocre buying into it, and then what are you teaching your kids? At home, your children. What have you taught them about when you have a job? You know, with kids, when you have a job, here's what you do. You really dive in. No, you don't. You just halfway do it. Just right. Mediocre, lukewarm, yeah. Do your job. You can put other things. So there's such a fine balancing act between being obsessed by that job at the expense of your family and giving that job the due diligence it deserves.
Right.
And boy, that's a tight
big.
Wire.
That's
right
big.
There.
And I think that's key, too, when I think of my own kids. Because I made it important. Both of my kids, I'm very proud of, and the fact that they have a work ethic. They saw, and that's the way I was with my dad. My dad worked 7 days a week. So that's all I knew was work. So it's just kind of going on and on like that, and my kids have picked up on that with my wife and I, and that's important. I think sometimes maybe we overdo it, but again, they know it's important. They know it's important.
So. Yep.
All right, Coach, let's talk about next week. Your thoughts on the tournament next week. Again, we say we're sad that Walker Valley and Bradley can't go. But what do you think Cleveland, how does Cleveland stand in going into next week?
I think Cleveland's going to walk. I think they're going to walk right through it. I think they got this time this week to get better, to get, you know, I don't know all their guys, what all their guys' problems are exactly. I think most of them are things that you can get over. A lot of broken arm and a cast, so. Hopefully that's the case. And, you know, just on paper, you got a combination. Me and Steve Henry talked this year. It's a combination this year of in Cleveland's situation is that, you know, they have a strong team. And the rest of the state is kind of down. Mm-hmm. You know, Cleveland's team could compete.
Al and I were talking about the other night.
Me and Steve sit up there, and me and Danny Gilbert at the match, too. I said, you know, you look around the state and the teams that we know and the people we're familiar with and Cleveland, Bradley, everybody, and say, you know, really, where are your Chris Debians? Where are your Quinn Gibsons, your Rusty Blackmans, your Kevin Wards, the guys that are just next level? They're going to go to Division One and wrestle on a Division One team, to Oklahoma State or the place we've sent people. You don't see the superstars this year for some reason. I don't know why I had to account for that. I don't know why it is. I'm not one of these old guys that says, well, it was tougher in my day and it's weak now. That's baloney. But it does ebb and flow.
Yeah.
It does ebb and flow, and it may be strong as it can ever be in 2 years, whatever, you don't know, and the superstars may emerge, but right now it is not super strong across the state. I can't really account for why that is. I just know what I see and what I read and who's beating who, and so it's a combination. That's not to downplay Cleveland, because they've got a strong team that can compete any year right now. They have a strong, strong team.
Well, they may be down the road as far as you mentioned before, too, down the road as far as weight class. All 14 weight classes are very competitive. And especially if they're healthy and got everybody in the right places, there's not a weak weight class there all the way through.
Right.
I can't even pick out one weight class that I would say this is, you know, a real bottom class. No,
right.
They're strong all the way through, and that's one reason why I think they've been so effective. And because not every team, you know, a lot of teams have 6 good wrestlers, 7 to 8 good wrestlers, and some mediocres and stuff like that. But they are, I think, as competitive down the line as I've seen them in a long time, maybe ever. I don't know, because sometimes you just have a weak weight class, and so that's been very, very impressive. I've been impressed with, I think Joy has handled things pretty well this year. I wouldn't have wrestled Trey the other night against Davis, but that's my opinion. See,
which one's Davis? Oh, Saudi?
Walker Valley.
Oh,
when
oh,
we
Walker
wrestled
Valley.
On Wednesday.
Oh. Yeah.
I
watched it online.
I just think when you got a freshman like that, and again, it's nothing against Joey, and I'm not sure. They had a reason for doing what they did. I'm not knocking them in any way. I just think sometimes you have to take, you know, when you got a freshman, he's doing so well. There was nothing gained because the match was over. You know, if there was something in there going to be gained or by team one, it's like that's over, done. And thank goodness nobody got hurt. So that's a kind of thing that you just do. And as a coach, he's a young coach. Sometimes, you know, maybe it was the right thing to do. Who do I know?
I think Joey's going to have to prove himself, and he's done nothing wrong that I've ever seen. I like his demeanor. He's a good guy. I don't know him personally, but I like watching him, the way he acts and conducts himself. But, you know, there's old-timers out there and people that are around wrestling for a long time, and Jake Gilson do the same thing. You got right now there are people that say, well, Joey is doing a great job. He's a heck of a guy. Give him all his credit he's due. But they're also saying, but
they're really not his kids.
They're not his kids.
Yes.
He's winning with what somebody else did.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you got every coach goes through that.
Oh, yeah.
Every coach goes through that, a new coach. And, you know, well, he's on, you know, things that happened before he even got there and the way it's set up. And it's unfair, perhaps, but he has opportunity in the next several years. Then he will prove himself,
exactly.
And he will prove his worth, and he will. People have to look back and say, you know what,
well,
he is the man, and he, you know. He didn't just inherit this dynasty. He's
got to
work at it.
One thing you have to, as a young coach, you have to understand and not be afraid to do. As you know, I was in a little different situation because back there wasn't anything before me. And so I kind of had to set the standard myself. But the idea of the fact that you got people like you and you got people like Turner and you got people you talk to. And Ben was probably, I think, one of the I think he handled that very well. He had a tough year his first year, too, in some situations.
He
but,
did.
You know, it's like following Benny Monroe. You follow Benny Monroe, who's just won 3 state championships in football, and you're the new head coach. Where you got to go? Where are you going to go? Yeah, it's a lose-lose. It doesn't matter what you do, even if you go to the playoffs 7 years in a row like Leon did. So those are the kind of things that you you have to be aware of, but you have to be willing to listen to somebody who's had been there a little longer. You know, take in something. I'm not saying you have to change your whole thing, but don't be afraid. You got to be humble. You got to be humble. You got to understand. You got to work with people. Ask people. Get some help. Don't be ashamed to ask. And I think Joey did a great job. One thing I think he did a great job is getting Nico and Soto up there. Because, I mean, he's got a heavyweight person to work. He's got a lower weight person to work. And Joey works a lot with the inside, you know. I mean, and these are guys, you know, I'm talking about getting on the mat and wrestling with them folks, too. So that's all key, and it's all big up there. And of course, again, we're talking about the volunteers. They're all over. So, but anyway, I agree with you. I don't think they're going to have a whole lot of competition next week. But again, you just never know what's going to happen. And you never know what, if Saudi gets through to the finals again against Cleveland. Now, they had a pretty good plan the other night. Maybe something will work. That's why you wrestle the match, folks. That's why you wrestle the matches. So,
I think that Cleveland will, if that were the final match, Cleveland and Saudi Daisy. You know, I think Cleveland is so much better right now than Saudi or Bradley that he probably give it a whole lot of thought about bumping anybody or what to do if and when. We're going to beat him regardless. I thought he felt like that. I would feel like that too in that position. I wouldn't say it. He didn't either, but I would think it, as he didn't worry much about it. I think now they were vaguely close to Cleveland in the region, vaguely, and you get in the state finals next weekend. I think then he'll have a plan. I remember sitting in O'Charlie's or whatever it was, Ruby Tuesday's up in Clarksville one year, scribbling on a napkin. I scribbled on a napkin. We ended up bumping 6 guys up in a row against Cleveland in the finals. They were thinking they're going to wrestle these guys, and I'm thinking it'd be better if we sit this guy in and bump this guy out instead of 6 guys up.
Right.
Things like that. Well, I think he'll put that brain into action for himself. And if they do meet Saudi next weekend in the finals, he'll have a plan.
Yep.
He'll say, if Cleveland slides in here, then we're going to bump here. You be ready. And if I point at you, you're going. If I point at him, he's going. That kind of a chess match.
Yeah.
And I think he'll put more effort into it next weekend because what's on the line and the fact that Saudi won some matches against him.
Yeah.
And I think that makes it fun. Fun
well,
for the crowd.
Well, it does. It works your mind. And, again, especially in your first year, and you're down to the situation now, you're in tournaments and all that kind of stuff that's going on. And you're right. The thought process there, especially next week, is because of the fact that it's duels. Now, after that, you got your people where they're supposed to be, and you just got to work with them. But again, I think it's going to be exciting. I think the next couple of weeks are going to be real exciting. You just never know. And when you get into that traditional, hey, anybody can be a – I mean, you can get some of these individual kids step up, and next thing you know, oh, my gosh, what's going on? So
I think the fun thing with the individual is that we'll talk about that. Well, I don't know if we're having more meetings.
This may be our last.
Okay, unless, we'll talk about it now then.
Because we got
right. That's
we
right.
Got next week's the tournament.
It's always been that way. When the tournament starts, in the individual, you know, I think that Cleveland's going to shine again, and unless some play goes through their lineup, they're going to shine again. They're going to have 9, 10, 11 placers. I mean, they have a lot of place winners, score a lot of points. I think they're going to walk away with it pretty easily. But even if you go, like, say, as a Bradley fan or a Soddy fan who not really in the hunt for the team championship, you can still go and hope for a second, third, or fourth trophy maybe, but you get to watch individuals win. You know, I can still have a 138-pounder that wins a state title
right.
and battle for that, and there's a lot of joy in that. And if your
Definitely.
Team doesn't win, man, you get so much satisfaction out of someone you love doing well and all his dreams coming true. So you'd have to focus just on the team race like you do with the duels.
Right.
You can focus on that and individual races, too, guys you really care about and love, and that makes that just a great experience. I'm going over, of course. I just love the whole environment of it. I loved it more when the environment itself was in Chattanooga at McClellan and at the Roundhouse. I thought it was a better environment, but it's still high school wrestling. It's still dreams coming true. It's still competition.
And, again, it gets down to folks, to the kids. It's all about the kids. It's not about us. And it's just seeing kids be successful. It always bothers me when someone who's been, I remember a year or two ago, I can't remember, maybe it was longer than that, we had a kid that was undefeated in the state, and I can't remember all the scenarios about, I don't know if it was a ringworm or a staff or something, but he's undefeated statewide, gets into, I think, the second day of wrestling and is disqualified. I don't know if he missed weight or whatever, and or had a staph infection, but again, that is, you hate to see those things happen to kids, but again, it all boils back to the coaching and the preparing kids and making sure that they're ready and go on like that. Sure, it is sad, but again, that's part of it, and you've got to prepare for it and make sure it works out for you. All right, Steve, listen, I tell you what, I've enjoyed these 3 weeks. I just don't see probably any reason why we need to do another one. I guess we might could do one before the regional the traditionals and talk about possibilities there. We'll wait and leave that open. We won't be having a show next week for sure because of the duels, and we'll consider about what we might do that following week before the traditionals, and we'll talk about it. But again, folks, we appreciate you tuning in, listening to what we have to say, and it's going to be exciting. I hope if you're a wrestling fan that you're going to get out there, and if you can get over there to the state next week, Newell's, watch Cleveland, and represent our area, and we'll pull for them. Hopefully they bring home the bacon, and then after that, everybody's back in. After next week, all three high schools, everybody's back in, and we'll be rooting for them and hoping everybody has a successful tournament. Coach, as always, I appreciate your time, your comments, and your expertise.
Well, thanks for having me, Coach. I've enjoyed it for years, and I hope to continue to.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you. Folks, y'all have a great Saturday, great weekend. Be safe, and hopefully we'll see you down the road. Have a great day. Thank you, big guy.
There you go. Why you'll ever understand them lights, they smoke, and loud music. You'll never make a wife to
the stars at night are big and bright, deep in the heart of Texas. The prairie sky is wide and high, deep in the heart of Texas. The coyotes wail along the trail, deep in the heart of Texas. The rabbits rush around the brush, deep in the heart of Texas. Chicken hawks are full of squawks
deep in the heart of Texas.
The oil wells are full of smell
deep in the heart.